Clock will call the meeting to order. If you would please stand for the invocation and pledge. Our gracious Heavenly Father, I want to thank you, Lord, for the many blessings of life and allowing us to gather freely. Please be with this meeting to help us make the best decisions for the people of Pickens County and according to your will. Please be with our county leaders, state leaders, and nation's leaders, as well as our troops fighting for our freedoms on foreign soil. And all these many favors and things we ask in our son's name. Amen.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Item two is reading and approval of last month's minutes.
Motion to approve.
There is one mistake in the second paragraph on the back there. It said that Jim made a motion, second by Tad Hobbs, to table the rezoning request. That wasn't correct. It was to approve it. On the third line from the bottom of the second paragraph on the back.
Regarding Rock Creek Mines.
Where it says to table the rezoning, it should be to approve.
Good catch, Pat.
Yes.
I'll reinstate my motion to approve.
We have a motion to approve.
I'll second.
We got a move in second. All those in favor of approval, please raise your hand. Motion carries unanimously. Item three is old business. We have text amendment, chapter 58, regarding solid waste. Is that still?
If y'all want me to speak to that.
You're Richard Warren.
I think y'all originally looked at this under planning and zoning. And when you regulate under that format, you're going to be regulating as far as property rights. This condition of trash, the conditions of nuisance, those can be regulated under the police powers of the state, which I don't know is really under. I mean, y'all are more planning and development. I don't know that you're into the police powers side of things. But it would be up to the Board of Commissioners if they wanted to regulate, and they could regulate it pursuant to their police powers in the manner that we've written out here, as far as the definition of commercial solid waste and then what the regulation of that would be.
What does commercial solid waste mean?
Trash. I mean paper, non-hazardous materials.
Would that include recyclables?
It would. Okay. It would be up to the landowner to segregate one from the other the way it's currently done.
So what this was requesting was to, have those items, those types of items, shielded so that they weren't visible.
The trash or the recyclables or both?
Both.
Yeah.
Whatever commercial solid waste
is. Yeah, that's how, the way it currently is, there is no distinction. They would all be shielded, yes.
Well, we've been at this, but this is our second or third. So I presume it's appropriate for us to make a recommendation.
If you see fit, like I said, this isn't necessarily land use regulation.
Right.
And it's more a regulation under the police powers of the state or of the county.
Which are not our particular issue, but nonetheless, we get.
You know, board's free to do what the board wants to do.
Yeah.
But as far as your normal parameters go.
And when does this take effect? Who does it affect? the way this is written.
It would affect everyone. It presumably would affect everyone immediately unless the Board of Commissioners says otherwise. And I think what you're getting at is the question of grandfathering, the question of vested rights. We really don't have, the issue of vested rights is not applicable when we're talking about the exercise of police power. That would be more along the lines of a non-conforming use. You know, I've got a half acre and I've built a house on it. You passed a regulation that says you can't have a house on less than 3 acres. Well, it's a non-conforming use, but I had a vested right in that and therefore you can't make me move my house.
Right. But you can make me move it.
Grandfathering status really doesn't apply to land use questions. We really just do a non-conforming use. Grandfathering is where under the police powers, the board, the governing authority decides to not apply this to a particular class for whatever reason. You know, we're not going to make everybody prior to this date comply with this regulation. And a lot of times when you see that, there's a difficulty or an issue with the enforcement of the ordinance, as I think there would be here.
Well, I was just thinking about, I mean, when this shielding thing surfaced many years ago, it had to do with junkyards.
Yes.
And
that was probably 10 years ago. No, that was 15 years ago.
And as I recall, I mean, that was made applicable to everyone that had a junkyard. What would be your distinction between what this is saying and junkyards? Not that I have anything against junkyards. I'm just saying that everyone that had a junkyard, I believe, had to screen it.
Didn't they have a time limit to apply and not just immediate?
I can't remember all the details of that. That was.
But it was applicable, as I recall, to everyone.
It was, but I don't think it passed, did it? At the time, I think that was when Frank Martin was commissioner.
Well, I wasn't necessarily speaking just to Pickens County, because I think a lot of different counties adopted that.
But when we talk about junkyards, I think one of the questions there is a question of the use of the land.
Right.
And there you do have vested rights in whether or not I am using my property as a junkyard now, or you know, if you have cows on it now, then you wanted to make it into a junkyard, you would have to comply with the new ordinance. You would not have a vested right.
Yeah, well, I was just speaking to the requirement to screen.
To screen.
Not to the use of the land, but the screening requirement.
It may have been that there were other restrictions in that ordinance, I can't remember, that made it more than just an exercise of the police power.
So as it's written right now, it would be applicable. It says solid waste, and solid waste is trash, recyclables, everything that would fall.
Everything that's non-industrial, basically non-hazardous, okay. I guess.
All right.
Heavy metals.
Do other counties in the area, Richard, have this type of regulations on businesses? Do you know?
They do. Yes, ma'am. It's typically the larger counties. I know Forsyth, Cherokee, and Bartow counties in the unincorporated and incorporated areas have them. Mm-hmm. And in cities that are places like, you know, Calhoun has it, Gordon does not have it, and I'm not aware of Dawson County, you know, in particular. So that, I just don't know if they do or not.
I think my only concern is for really small companies, if they had to build this wall and a gate, it might be so cost prohibitive that they just wouldn't recycle. I don't know. It was just.
Any other questions or comments?
I would make a motion to approve the recommended language concerning commercial solid waste as presented.
I would move to approve the definition of solid waste as presented. Better a second?
Second.
Second.
Any discussion?
Are we certain that recyclable materials follow their solid waste definitions according to Georgia's code?
I probably do, I mean.
Just check.
Any other discussion?
Okay, he said the definition of commercial solid waste, does that also include M down there, the commercial solid waste refuse areas? When you made your motion, did you include M in that as well, it's just the definition of commercial solid waste?
Yes.
Okay.
Any other discussion? All those in favor, please raise your hand. All those opposed? Motion carries.
Can I ask a question now?
Sure.
Now that it's passed, I mean, I'm thrilled that you want to oppose this on it immediately. You think you'll get some people pushed back on you when they have to do it tomorrow? Should you maybe have given them 6 months or something reasonable to do it?
This will go before the board of commissioners for final passage and approval.
I'm just trying to say that in order to be fair to our neighbors, you know, I'm trying to say, give them some time to react to it. Give them some, for people that are currently occupying buildings, you know, the new buildings, it would have to be part of their site plan, right? Before it got approved, but to be fair to the people that have existing buildings, maybe you might want to suggest to the county commissioners that they put a clause in there that says, hey, existing inhabited buildings have 6 months to comply. Just a suggestion. Is that the dumb thing to say?
No. But I think we'll let Richard and Bill.
Yeah, they'll hash that out with the board of commissioners.
Good deal.
Next item is new business. We do have a couple of new items and new business. The first is conditional use. We'll open up a public hearing for that. For Mr. and Ms. Higginbotham, I'd ask Richard what the county's recommendations.
Thank you, Mr. Cagle. So there's an existing agritourism business at this property, Fainting Goats Vineyards, and the proposal is to expand the operations to include weddings and more special events. Fainting Goats has already got an alcohol license and a business license, and the comprehensive plan for Northeast Pickens is rural development and conservation, and agritourism falls in line with that. So it not only meets the intent of the conference plan, but the proposal to expand an existing business is less intense than a brand new conditional use proposal for a business. So staff recommends approval.
Mr. or Ms. Higginbotham, mm-hmm. Anything y'all would like to add?
Sure, I'd just like to say, guys, everyone I know, most of you all know me. My name's David Higginbotham. I own Fainting Goat Vineyards along with my wife Robin and my daughter Mackenzie. We've been open now for a year and a half. We have not had anything negative as far as an impact goes on the community. In fact, we've had quite a bit of plus to this community. And that's the main reason why we want to pursue what we're doing right now. All of our neighbors who come in, all of the county that comes in, everybody is looking for weddings, corporate events, birthday parties, things along that line. Remember, we're definitely a boutique vineyard. We will also be a boutique venue. We're not having 200, 300, or 400 people at any type of an event. We don't have that kind of a negative impact anywhere. We're very sustainable in our farming aspect of what we do. We've had quite a plus impact on the soil up there. We have no erosion problems. Our parking is very well. And everything that we do is basically all that community inspired. When people come to us, they say, oh, what a beautiful building. And then what really catches them is a mountain view. You know, I said, well, I built the building, God took care of everything else. You know, it can really just enjoy what is there. We've made a few additions to our business due to the fact that the black bear last year doing wrecking havoc with us. We put up a fence around the vineyard, and I bought two small Great Pyrenees puppies who now patrol the vineyard. You know, the easiest way to keep the bear out is to have the dogs in there. And then we also have two small fainting goats, which are bred with dwarf goats, so they stay very small. The goats are Ronnie and Reagan. They were named after President Reagan. And the dogs are Teddy and Rosie, named after Theodore Roosevelt. So, and, you know, you guys, some of you have been there, some of you haven't, but please stop up there and see us. It's a beautiful, serene place to be. Any questions from anybody?
So what do the goats do for you other than...
Other than have people look at them and it's come to me and say, there's something wrong with your goats, they don't faint. You know, the thing with fainting goats is they only faint when they want to. They almost have to be cornered. You can go boo and do whatever you want, they don't faint. But if you get it cornered, then they fall over and they, you know, they're stiff for 5 seconds, they get back up. So, and that way we have everything fenced in and nobody gets in there to do that. So naturally they think there's something wrong with my goats, but, you know. So, but other than that, it's been great.
So how are the vineyards coming along?
Great. Our Cabernet last year, it was a smaller harvest than what I had wanted. You know, the drought came in, you guys all know that. So far this year, what we've been doing is just reseeding grass. I mean, I've got more money from Brad Stevens and Fescue and stuff like that going on right now than I know what to do with. But it's just a matter now of regrowing. Nothing up there has started to bud out yet. So we'll see what the damage is from last year's drought as spring approaches. Like I said, our Cabernet, what we have right now in the oak barrels, is just absolutely great. The soil conditions up there are perfect for wine. They really are. Anything else?
I see you're actually planning on closing these events at 6 p.m.
We close every day at 6 p.m. Now, events, most of those will all close at 6, depending on what they are. A wedding will go a little bit longer, probably at 8 or 9 o'clock at night. You know, that'll be depending on that. Also, what we do there is, in our plan is, for security-wise, we will hire, at least our main plan is to hire off-duty sheriff department to oversee that. It's the best way to keep the community where it is. And like I said, again, we're not a bar, we are a winery. It's a very different clientele, it's a very different class than what you find at a bar.
So how large a group can you anticipate accommodating?
We can get up to 100, we can't go over that. There's just no room for that unless you would just have them scattered throughout the vines. And that's not a good thing.
The dog wouldn't like that.
No, they sure wouldn't. That's their job to protect it, so they wouldn't be real happy.
And they haven't budded out yet, so this week's freeze?
No, this week's freeze is not going to affect me.
Okay.
So I did all the rough pruning already, but I always leave all the shoots. So if the frost hits, it always hits the top. I'll go back later on and cut it off. So we'll be ready to go this year.
Very good.
Thank you.
Are there any other questions for Mr. Higginbotham?
I make a motion to approve.
Second. I have a motion and a second to approve. Any discussion? All those in favor, please raise your hand. Motion carries. That hearing is closed. We'll open up another public hearing for item B, the text amendment for land use intensity.
Thank you, Cagle. Every year I attend legal and non-legal training for planning and zoning, and part of that training that's stressed to planning and zoning administrators is that the actual official map, most places call it official zoning map, here it's called the official land use map. The training that we get is that based on the state zoning procedures law and other parts of the official code of Georgia, that the official map related to zoning needs to be readopted approximately once a year. The last time it was adopted by the Board of Commissioners was January 2016. So this is the draft that includes the last year's worth of rezonings and when there's been a parcel split or other type of subdivision, it includes that. And let's say the parent parcel is agriculture. Then if it goes from one to two or three lots, then all of those lots, keep the same zoning, in this case of agriculture. And you'll see there, most of the color is gray and blue, noting that in unincorporated Pickens, we have a lot of properties zoned agriculture and rural residential. Everything in white is in city limits of either Jasper or Nelson. And so, you know, again, no significant changes. And then as part of the training that I get, what the recommendation is from different attorneys and other land use folks is that the code of ordinances chapter related to the official map that deals with the zoning districts, that every few years it get readopted by the governing authority. And so really this text amendment is two part for this year. One part on the map, and then one part to readopt Chapter 67, which is called Land Use Intensity Districts and Map. And there's no significant changes. I will note the two changes that I have included. Right now, we have a use called campgrounds. The definition of it is not in this Chapter 67. It's in our code of ordinances, but it's in a different chapter, Chapter 38, Land Development Regulations. And so really the proposal first is to copy and paste so that the definition of campground will be in Chapter 67. So again, no new language, just copying and pasting. And then the second is, in the last 15 plus years, there have been court cases and clarifications about what a church is, the most famous of which is the Religious Land Use and Institutionalized Person Act of 2000, referred to as RLUIPA. And it really limits restrictions on churches, meaning that churches are a good thing. And they should be allowed, when applicable, more than prohibited. So right now, there's an existing definition that Pickens County has for what a church is and is not. And it's not necessarily that we need to replace the definition, but I've just got a proposal based on other counties to have a simplified definition that a church would, as proposed, be a building or a group of buildings in which persons assemble for religious worship intended primarily for purposes connected with such worship or for teaching a particular form of religious belief. And again, you know, it's not a huge thing, but it's really just to simplify our existing definition of a church.
Any questions for Richard?
Yes, you've removed schools and kindergartens. Does that mean that churches can no longer have those?
No, ma'am. The proposal simplifies the definition of what a church is defined as, so that it doesn't necessarily say, if you're a church and you have property, you can do this, but you cannot do that. It just says, you know, here's the definition of a church. What the last 15 plus years of court cases and clarifications have taught planning and zoning administrators is, when a church has a property, 100 acres or 10 acres, they can not only have the church building, but they can have ball fields, they can have a cemetery, they can have a school, they can have a thrift store, different things like that. And it's ancillary or accessory uses to their church. It's part of their purpose. And so really just simplifying it just says, here's the definition of a church. And for the most part, we, you know, as at least I can just speak for myself, you know, I don't have a problem with churches, and in our zoning part of the code of ordinances, typically churches are allowed in a variety of zoning districts.
So, so Richard, this would, since the other language specifically addressed certain types of things that might go on in the church, this is just, this is essentially broadening it and allowing the church to do anything that this definition allows, which...
It essentially is risk averse in the sense that, for example, right now the definition specifically says, here's what a church is, and if a church wants to have a thrift slash clothing store, that shall not be considered one of the accessory uses of a church. Well, in the very unlikely event, but still possible, that a church wants to open up a thrift store on the same property of a church, and for whatever reason, a Pickens County staff person says, no, I look in this definition and it says you can't do it, so, you know, I deny it. And then the church, you know, a couple of members get upset and a lawsuit ensues. There's the potential, however unlikely, you know, based on court cases of the last 15 plus years, that, you know, the church might have a, you know, foundation for saying, you know, county government staff person, you should not have denied me my right to have a thrift store on my church property, because that's part of our mission to provide outreach or whatever they might have as a reason. So it's, you know, it's again, it's, you know, kind of just not wanting to put us in a risk position.
The thing is that while churches are allowed in most use areas, some of the things they do, like daycare centers, are not. So if you don't have it in there that they are allowed, that is part of the definition, I'm just wondering if that's going to be a problem in the future for people in other zones not wanting the church there, or not wanting the church to have some daycare centers or schools, based on the fact that it's not allowed.
Well, it's not allowed, but it's also not prohibited.
Right. Right now, if a church wants to have a daycare, they can, per the definition. And then, per the new definition, they could still have a daycare. They could have a variety of things. They could just say, we're primarily a church. That's our use on the property. We have 10 other accessory uses that we do, but we're primarily a church. You know, on Tuesdays we have, you know, our bread guild. On, you know, Thursdays we have our baking part. On, you know, I don't know, Wednesdays we have our Bible study, and we have sports games on our ball field. You know, but that's all under the umbrella of we're a church. That's our primary use.
And Richard, is this definition from some other official government language, or is this just something that you can look at?
It's a combination of looking at other North Georgia counties. Yes, sir.
Because I noticed in the old definition, where the word religion is used, it talks about organized religious services. And the new definition just simply says form of religious beliefs. I think that may be a little too broad. I can understand the need to eliminate risk, but I don't want to open up the potential for risk. And according to this definition, basically my house should follow this definition. So I can understand the need to not be so restrictive, but I don't want to go too far the other direction either and open it up. And I think organized religious or organized religion is a key phrase in the deleted division that should somehow be maintained in the new definition. You know, most religious beliefs established in the country referred to as organized religion. Now, I don't know if that was intended in the original definition to refer back to that in some legal ways, but I think that just says form of religious belief may be a little too broad and opening up well beyond the means of organized religious services, is my concern.
What may be appropriate is just keeping the existing first sentence of the existing definition. Building or structure or groups of buildings or structures that by design and construction is primarily intended for conducting organized religious services.
I don't have a problem with that.
Phil?
How are you going to define organized religion? And I don't think we, that's what worries me about that.
So are you saying you prefer the proposed language, or which one?
I'm thinking that the old language was fine.
Yeah, I mean, the purpose is to not be limiting from the old definition, and just remove the aspects of the old definition that are limiting.
Just the two definitions.
I don't think we need to recreate anything necessarily.
Maybe perhaps we ought to keep the first two sentences of the original.
The only thing to have less risk that could be appropriate then would be to just strike the last statement of the existing definition that reads, however, a parsonage, thrift/clothing store, and homeless shelters/kitchens shall not be considered accessory uses. Really, everything before that is, you know, appropriate.
Says however,
so you see, proposed to replace with. So it would just be a simplified definition. Church.
No, you're going blending these.
Okay, so as proposed now, the existing definition would stay, but the last phrase would be deleted. However, a parsonage, thrift clothing store, and homeless shelters, kitchen shall not be considered accessory uses. Just to delete that phrase.
Yeah. I think that would be better than the proposal, okay. Because in the definition that we have now is the building is intended for conducting religious worship, whereas in the proposal it's anybody meeting in a basement.
Any other questions?
Mr. Chairman, I move that we adopt the we not adopt the proposed replacement language, but keep the original language, striking the phrase, however, a parsonage, thrift store, and homeless shelter shall not be considered accessory uses.
And the motion to alter the existing definition by removing a phrase, the last phrase there.
Second.
And move in second. Any discussion? All those in favor, please raise your hand. Motion carried. That closes that hearing. Item five is board comments. Any comments from the board? Next item is public comments. Any questions or comments from the public? Next and last item is adjournment. Do I hear a motion to adjourn?
So moved. Second.
And moving second, any discussion? All those in favor, please raise your hand. Meeting adjourned.